Hi, this is the 11th lecture of the deep learning course, and today is about recurrent neural networks and natural language processing. So this, of course, will be quite a short introduction to those topics because they deserve, each of them deserve a full course. So we start with the recurrent neural networks. So recurrent neural networks were introduced mostly to process sequences. So in many real-world problems, we cannot cast the task as we did until now, which is we have a fixed size input from which we have to compute a value, a class or a quantity. But in many problems, the size of the input signal depends with the actual sample. So usually it's simply because it's a sequence that can be a sound sample or a video or even any object whose length is not constant. So as for what we have seen until now, sequences can be used for classification. So typically sentiment analysis, where you get the input sequence would be a snippet of text, and you have to predict if it's, let's say, a positive or a negative text. And it's quite a complicated task because there are many subtleties in the language that create ambiguities. It can be activity or action recognition, where the input sequence would be a video, for instance, and you have to predict, let's say, if it's a sport video, if you have to predict if it's an attack or a defense action. It can be DNA sequence classification or even action selection, where the input to your system would be the sequence of what has been done and observed so far, and you have to predict which is the optimal next action to do. It can also sequences can also be used for synthesis. So in which case you want to build an architecture that gets, as for image synthesis, it would get random noise and output a sequence of a certain type. So it can be text, music, or motion. Motion synthesis would be to predict joint angles or the forces to apply to motors to produce motion that mimic motions seen during training. And finally, you have sequence-to-sequence translation, where you get a sequence and you output a sequence. So the canonical example would be speech recognition, where your input sequence would be directly the sound itself, and the output sequence would be characters or words. Text translation, you would get a text and output text in a different language. And part of speech tagging would be you get as an input text, so a bunch of characters, and you have to tag every single word with its grammatical function. So we can make this a little bit formal. We introduce X is the space of the element of the sequence. So it can be, if it's characters, it's a finite set. If it's words, it's also a finite set with a larger cardinality. But it can also be an image, it can also be a single scalar if it's sound volume, or it can be a high dimension vector, for instance, if you do one hot vector encoding, as we will do in some of the examples. So I will use S of X, the set of sequences, which is a set of, it can be seen as a set of vectors of one dimension, but undefined length. So I take the union over all the lengths of vectors or sequences of length t built with elements from big X. So now, given this notation, sequence classification would be a classifier would be a mapping from the space of the set of sequences to the set of classes. Synthesis would be from a fixed Euclidean space, a fixed number of values, which would be random noise. You want to predict a sequence taken from your sequence set. And sequence-to-sequence translation would be you get a sequence with elements in a certain space and you produce a sequence with elements in another space. So this could be sound volume, and this could be characters, or this could be characters, and this could be characters. Or this could be words, and this could be grammatical tagging. So in the rest of the slides for today, I will only consider time sequences, so elements indexed by time. But of course, all this generalizes to any other type of sequence. As long as you index in a 1D manner with a discrete quantity, you're good to go. So it could be, you could even consider, for instance, stacks of images coming from microscopy. As long as you don't know in advance the size of the stack, it could be cast as a sequence classification problem. Okay, so the key tool that has been used historically for processing sequences are the recurrent neural networks, RNN. And what we are going to see in the coming slides is what is a recurrent neural network and how we train it. And we will see that it's extremely similar to what we have done for deep neural networks. So a recurrent model maintains a recurrent state updated at each time step. This is a key element. So instead of being a feed-forward structure where you put a quantity and then you push it through the elements, through the layers one after another, and in the end you get the value of interest. In your recurrent neural network, you are going to get one after another the values from your sequence, and your neural net, your architecture on your neural network will take its current recurrent state and the current element from the sequence and compute a new recurrent state and progress like this. So it's really, it's going to visit the element from the sequence one after another and keep updated through those elements its own internal state, which is going to be updated. So the very notion of recurrent neural networks is to train them so that they will discover what is the meaningful information to keep in this recurrent state, which is quite a complicated problem. So now I'm going to focus on the case where the elements of the sequences are vector of dimension d, and given an input sequence from this set, and an initial recurrent state h0, so the canonical letter is H for the recurrent state, which is hidden, but then there is a confusion with the inner state in a MLP, so I will call them recurrent state and use H to denote them. And then the model would compute the sequence of recurrent state as follows, which is the next recurrent state is a function, which is a model of what is the element at this moment in the sequence and the previous recurrent state. And the model takes an element from the sequence, the current recurrent state, and output the new recurrent state. So then, given this, it will produce a new sequence of recurrent state. So you start with H0, and then given X1 to X big T, you will get H1 to H big T. And at any moment, you can compute a prediction from this hidden state with another model, which would be YT equal Psi of HT, where Psi goes from the space of the recurrent, the dimension of the recurrent state into the space where you actually want to make a prediction. So graphically, it looks like this. You have your recurrent model that takes as input a recurrent state and an element from the sequence, and of course the parameter of the model, and it produces a new recurrent state. And then you do it again, you take the next value in the sequence, current recurrent state, pass it sur le modèle and compute a new recurrent state. And you go on like this until you get your final recurrent state. Okay? And what you can do is either to take the parameter. So here I called W both the parameters of the recurrent model and the parameter of the readout model, Psi. Either you make a final prediction. So this would be, for instance, for classification. This is the sequence of, let's say, sound volumes, sound amplitude, and I just want to predict in the end which was the word which was said during this sequence. But you can also make a prediction at any moment. So this could be, for instance, words, and you want to translate them into words in a different language. The key thing to keep from this slide is that even though the size of this figure depends on the sample, because t is a function of x, this is a key thing. The sequence, the length of the sequence here depends on x. Even though big T depends on x, here we see something formally identical to what we have seen so far, which is a bunch of tensor operations parameterized by parameter with an input signal on the final quantity. So now we can completely deal with this with autograd as we did before. We can simply run the computation and in the end compute derivatives of whatever we need to do training. So this idea of backpropagating through this graph, which now has this particular property, which the multiplicity of the modules correspond to the multiple time steps, this is referred historically to as backpropagation through time. But I insist, because for me this is the kind of stuff that may give you the impression it's a very special case. It's actually not. It's really a standard bunch of graph of tensor operations with heavy weight sharing, because it is the same weight that the same parameters that parameterizes all the phi and the psi in this graph. So there is heavy weight shearing, this guy and this guy and this guy and this guy are all the same model, parameters with the same parameter. But otherwise, the second difference with what we have seen so far is that the number of blocks and the number of operations in this graph depend on the sample. Otherwise, it's exactly like what we have the stuff we have seen until now. You can really apply autograd and say, for instance, okay, now I want the derivative of this guy, W, with respect to whatever loss I put over this guy. And this will work exactly as usual. So in the coming slides, I'm going to show a few models, so very simple ones, and the two standard ones called LCM and GRU. And to illustrate how they work and how they perform, I will look at this very simple sequence classification task. So in this task, the input sequence are of even length, so they are composed of two half of same length. And there are two classes, so class 1 are sequences which are composed of two identical halves, and class 0 are all the other sequences. So the way I generate the train on the test set is simply to first flip a coin with probability 1 half to set the class, and then given the class, either I generate uniformly half of the sequence and copy it in the second half, or I generate the full sequence uniformly and just regenerate it if by chance I end up being having two identical halves. So in the different models we will see, we will use all the nonlinearities. So this is just a reminder that ReLU is this nonlinearity which is zero on the negative side and identity on the positive. Hyperbolic tangent is this nonlinearity which is identity at zero that goes between minus 1 and plus 1, is symmetric and has exponential squashing on both sides. And the sigmoid is very similar to the hyperbolic tangent except that it goes between 0 and 1 instead of going between minus 1 and 1. So the first model, the simplest one, is called the Nelman network, and it's simply that the updated recurrent state is a nonlinearity, in that case ReLU, applied to a linear function of the element from the input from the sequence and the current recurrent state and the bias. So it's very simple. And the readout is a linear function of the recurrent state. So we can't make it simpler because if, of course, as for the MLP, if there was no nonlinearity, this would be an overall linear function that would be not expressive enough. But otherwise, it's really the minimum we can do. And this, we can implement this as follows in PyTorch. So I define a class RecNet, which is inherited from module. It has a linear model to combine the corresponding to this white matrix and actually this bias that takes elements from the sequence and produce an update of the hidden state. And we also have a linear model that goes from the hidden state to the hidden state. This guy, I set bias to false because we already have a bias in this one, so it would be it's useless to have also another one since we sum the two. And then we have the readout model, which is again a linear model that takes the recurrent state and produce the output state. The constructor gets as input the dimension of the input, the dimension of the recurrent, and the dimension of the output state. And now the forward, if we get a sequence input. So here I'm going to consider, to make everything simple in the coming slides, I'm going to consider that my model gets a single sequence as input. But of course, we can, when we use this for real size problems, we would want to use mi-batch, and then we will have to use a batch which is of length, maximum length of all the sequences in the batch, and it starts to be a bit technical. So to concentrate, to focus on the aspect of the recurrent neural networks and not on all those technical aspects, I will process sample one by one. So here my update of I set my hidden state initially to zero, so I build a vector which is of the dimension of the input to this model that goes from the hidden to the readout, to the output value. So here I initialize my hidden state to zero, and then I'm visiting the sequence, so I loop through all the elements of the input, all the rows, and then I update my hidden state by applying ReLU to the linear model applied to the input plus the linear model applied to the current recurrent state. So linear model going from recurrent to recurrent applied to the recurrent, and linear model going from the sequence element to the hidden applied to the element in the sequence at time t. And then when I'm done, I just compute the final prediction from the final the final value of the recurrent state. Okay. So now to use this model, I first define a sequence generator. So I wrote a piece of code to a new class to generate sequences. So here I state that my sequences have 10 symbols, so digits from 0 to 9. That the length, so this is the path, what I call the pattern length, which is the length of half of the sequence. So half, the half of the sequence can be as small as 1 and as long as 10 symbols. And I want an encoding with 100 vectors, and I want my the tensor I get to be set as variables, so to be wrapped in variables. And then I define my recurrent network, so the input to the network, what is the dimension of the elements from the sequence is 10, which corresponds to the number of symbols. The recurrent state is of dimension 50, this is an arbitrary choice, but I'm going to roughly equalize the number of parameters of all the models I'm going to show in the coming slides. And the dimension of the output is 2. My criterion, my training criterion is cross entropy as usual, my optimizer is Adam. And here what I do is that I'm going to repeat my gradient step one sample by one sample. So this is a number fixed as a parameter. It will be several thousands, hundreds of thousands even. And then at every step I get a sequence, the real class. I compute the output of my model, so I will get a two-dimension output because I have two classes. And then I compute my loss and do my stuff as usual. So this again shows the power of AutoGrad because, again, I know I maybe sound a bit insistent with this, but even though here it's quite a different context where we do so-called backpropagation through time, for us it's simply I do my computation as usual, and by the way now I need the derivative of the parameters of the loss with respect to the parameters and just do it. So this is the performance, error rate, computed on a validation set as a function of the number of sequences seen during training, so it's a number of samples. And we see that it goes down to less than 10% error. So as one of my colleagues remarked, the problem I want to solve is quite easy because since the class 0, the sequences of the class 0 are generated uniformly, as soon as there is discrepancy of a single digit between the two halves, you can predict very strongly you have only a probability 1 out of 10 that it would be of class 0. So basically what the network has to learn is simply to compare one symbol in the first half with its corresponding symbol in the second half, which it's not so easy. But it means it does not have, it's true that it does not have to reach this level of this kind of performance, it does not have to compare the full halves. It can just check that one symbol matches and then makes the prediction based on this. And we can also plot the error rate as a function of the length of the test sequence, and we see that as expected, the longer the sequence, the more it's likely to be wrong. It's what is interesting is that it's saturated. It's 14 is worse than 2, but then 20 is not worse than 14. Okay, so now we come to maybe the key element to make a recurrent neural network efficient, which is the notion of gating. So if you reconsider what I just described and you look at this model expanded in time, it's really like a deep neural network because you just have a bunch of layers which are, you have as many layers as there is time step in your sequence. There is heavy weight sharing, but besides this aspect of weight sharing on the different lengths that depend with the sample, otherwise it's exactly the stuff we have seen until now. It's a very deep multi-layer perceptron. So we have to deal in this context with the usual thing we saw, the usual problems we saw for deep learning, which is in particular the vanishing gradient. And an important idea in the recurrent neural network models, which is very central in practice, is to add in a form or another a pass-through that's very similar to what we saw for the residual networks, so that the recurrent state does not go repeatedly through a squashing nonlinearity. So this takes its roots in the early time of the recurrent neural networks in the 90s, and they very early had this idea that we should also not only process the signal as usual through a hyperbolic tangent and such, but also to have a kind of a second stream of information that flows through the model without being squashed on the, to protect the gradient from vanishing. So in practice, for instance, what we can do is simply to compute the full update as we did before. So you have your recurrent state from which you compute a full update that I'm going to call HT bar as we did before. But now we are also going to compute a weighting ZT that is going to modulate how much we take into account the full update. So for a certain value of ZT, the full update will be completely ignored and the recurrent state will be kept unchanged. For ZT equal 1, we will completely take the full update. So the other way around, sorry. ZT plays the role of a forget gate. So if ZT equal 1, you completely keep the previous state. And if ZT equal 0, you completely take the update state. So in practice, what it means that now we have a new functional called the gating. They take as input the current symbol from the sequence, the current state from the sequence on the recurrent state, and from this element from the sequence on the recurrent state, it just predicts for every dimension, every component of the recurrent state, if it should be completely updated or completely kept non-updated. And now what it means, we do as usual, so we compute the gating values, what I'm going to call ZT, you compute the full update which corresponds to the update we had in the precedent model, HT bar, and then the actual update we do is a weighted average between the full update HT bar and non-update the previous recurrent state HT. Okay, and this is related quantwise. So this dot in a circle is the Hadamard product, which is component per component. So basically, what it means is that for ZT equal 1, if ZT equal 1 is a certain component, we completely keep the previous value in the previous recurrent state, and if ZT equals 0, we completely take the new update. So now that we have this is an update of our very simple model, and in practice what it means for the exact expression of our Hellman model, it means that before we had this, HT equal ReLU of a linear function of XT plus linear function of HT plus bias, and now we have HT bar is the same stuff. ZT, we want to be between 0 and 1, so we use a sigmoid that is going to squash the value between 0 and 1. Again, we use a linear model, we take the simplest case, and we do the update as said in the previous slide. So this is an update of our very simple recurrent model. We can implement it as follows in PyTorch, so we keep the same except that now we have also linear models for the gating, for the forget gate, which are those two guys. And now the update is, we compute the Z, as we did for the H. H bar is a full update, which is the same expression as before, and now the update, the actual update, takes the form of exactly Hadamard product, so the star in PyTorch is a component-wise product. So I take my Z component-wise H plus 1 minus Z component-wise HB, which is a full update. So it's really a direct implementation of the quantity in the previous slides. And if now I train this with exactly the same training procedure as before, so exactly the same thing, I don't change at all the gradient descent on the optimization part. This is the performance I get, so we are quite happy because now the error rate goes down to below 3%, 2.5 something. Everything else is the same. So this shows you the efficiency of the gating mechanism, because I really put it in the most naive way. And I also, by the way, equalize the number of parameters. So I pick my dimension of the recurrent state so that the number of parameters is the same as before. And we strongly reduce the error rate. And also, those runs are quite nice, but actually, if you do multiple runs for the naive one, you often end up with very bad models. So the training is far more unstable with this guy than with this guy. And if we look now at the error rate as a function of the sequence length, we are quite happy because it's the same behavior, it does not collapse. Maybe it increases a bit more in the end, but it's not really catastrophic for getting at some point. So now we come to the two standard models which are used for processing sequences in the deep learning world. The most famous one is LSTM, and GRU is a more recent version, which is slightly simplified. So the idea behind LSTM is a gating mechanism. So this was a model developed in 97 by Schmidhuber's group. And from the start, they wanted to deal with the vanishing gradient problem, which appeared again in the world of the recurrent neural networks earlier than in the world of convolutional networks. So the LSTM has a recurrent state called a cell state. It has actually a recurrent state in two parts. We will see this in the next slides. One is the cell state, so the CT. And as we can see, the update rule from the 97 version of LSTM is really the cell state. The update of the cell state is the previous value plus a gating function time full update. So it's very similar to what we saw in our simple gating example in the previous slides, except that it's not a weighted average. It's really the previous value plus gating time full update. What is interesting is that this strategy is very, very similar to the residual networks which were developed 20 years later, so in 2015. And actually, it's more than that. So the original architecture from 97 was improved the forget gate, which make it more similar to something for vision called highway networks. But the overall message is that the solution that the LSTM provide for the vanishing gradient is very, very close to the residual networks. You can really see LSTM as some sort of residual network where the number of layers is the number of time steps, and you have a complete weight parameter sharing between the blocks. What I'm going to show here is what I'm going to use our notation on the convention from the 2015 paper by Josefovic et al. The recurrent state for LSTM is composed of a cell state CT, and an output state HT. And we have a gate that modulates if the cell state should be forgotten or not, another gate that modulates if the new update should be taken into account or not, and finally, a final one that says if we should reset the output state or not. So the full update expression is as follows, and it's quite complicated, so don't be... It's normal if you feel a bit overwhelmed by those expressions, but the forget gate is a linear expression of the sequence element plus output state plus a bias, and you take a sigmoid, so this is between 0 and 1. The input gate is similar, it's the same kind of expression. The full cell update is similar, except that now the values go between minus 1 and plus 1, because the linearity is hyperbolic tangent. The cell state is very similar again to our gating example, because in the 2000 version, you have one gate that modulates how much you take into account the full update, and another gate that states how much you should forget or keep the previous cell state. Then the output state is a function also of the current sequence element on the previous output state on the bias. And finally, this is the output gate, sorry. And the output state is the output gate time, the expression coming from the cell state. So a technical point which was noted in 2000 is that the forget bias, so BF, should be initialized with large values, so that initially you do not have a forgetting effect, and initially the cell state update looks like really a residual one, so you really keep the previous one unchanged and you just add a perturbation to it. And also something I will not describe, but which is an extension from 2003, is the notion of peephole connections, where the gates also depend on the cell state. So here, the gate FT, IT, and OT just look at the element from the sequence on the output state. Okay, you just see a bunch of X's here and a bunch of H here. But you can, of course, add another term that is exactly the same form, but now is dependent on CT and not only XT and HT minus 1. So this is a so-called peephole connection, in the sense that the cell, the LSTM cell, can look at its own state to modulate it. So we can represent a LSTM cell similar to what I described before, like this. So you have the cell state, the output, the so-called output state. The both together would be the full recurrent state of the LSTM. So this is the stuff which is kept and updated through time. And then you get the element from the sequence, the current recurrent state, and you produce a new output state and a new cell state. And this part of the recurrent state is called the output state because this is the one used to, if you want to make a final prediction, this is what you would look at to make your prediction at this time step. And the name, output state, because it's the one you use to make the prediction. This is a LSTM cell, and you can actually combine several of them. So here I combine two of them to build a multi-layer, a two-layer LSTM. And it's basically the same stuff. Now, the only thing is that you have one output state and one cell state per cell. And the first cell, the first level of the first cell gets the input from the sequence. And the other one will get the output state from the previous cell is entered as the input from the next cell. And you can stack a bunch of them. So this is typically a two-layer LSTM. It's just a way of increasing capacity in a similar way as you would do with a multi-layer network. So PyTorch provides an implementation of this module called TorchNNLSTM. So it processes several sequences, so it can get a batch of sequences, and it will return two tensors. So it will process the full sequence, and in the end, the forward will give you two elements. The first tensor will be the output state for all the layers at the last time step. So you will get a tensor which one of the index will be the layer index, but you have no way of indexing the time. And the second tensor will be the output for the last layer, but for all the time steps. In which case you have no way of indexing the layer, but you have a way of indexing the time. And you can also specify the initial recurrent state, so both the output state H and the cell state C. As for non-recurrent models, it's quite important to process samples by batches. So if you want to process a bunch of sequences of same length, then you can put them in a 3D tensor, whose first index will be the time, second index will be the sequence number, and third index will be the feature. But you may have to deal in certain cases with sequences of different lengths. In that case, what you can do is to use the type packed sequence. So the type packed sequence can be created with the method packed sequence. And it works as follows. So here I import the function to create this object. And this function gets two parameters. One is a tensor that contains the actual features from the sequences. So here I have two sequences. The first is of length 3, the second is of length 2. So this coefficient is useless and I put 0. And they also have to pass as a second parameter to this function, a long tensor that contains the length of the sequences. And from this, it will create this object where it actually does not use memory to store the new coefficients. And it stores in a separate tensor, actually the length in the not in time, but through sequences of the used coefficients. But we don't need to understand exactly the inner structure of this type. What we need to know is that we can create it and we can pass it to the recurrent modules, in which case the output of the forward will be a similarly packed type. The important technical detail is that you have to sort the sequences in decreasing length. So the padded coefficients, the zeros, have to be in a sort of below diagonal shape. And there is another method to go back from the packed sequences to the pad tensor. Okay, so now, given all this, we can implement a network that uses the LSTM module from PyTorch. So I'm going to write it in a way that it will process sequence one by one so that I can reuse all my training procedure, all the training procedure I developed in the previous slides for my toy example. So my constructor will take the dimension of the input, the dimension of the recurrent state, the number of layers because we can have multiple LSTM layers, and the dimension of the output. And this network simply has an LSTM module and a readout, which is a linear model. On the forward is quite simple. I just the only trick is that since I want to process sequence by one, I have to add an additional index because the LSTM module expects a batch of sequences. So, and as I said, the sequence index is a second index, so index one. So I have to call this when I call this unsqueeze function, it just adds an additional index in place one, so the second index, and it will be a value, it will take only one value. So basically I make a batch of a single sequence that then I can pass to the LSTM module. I get back the two tensors, as I said before, one being the activation of all the layers at the last time step, and the other one being the activation of the last layer at all the time steps. Then I drop the batch index, because again, I want a single sequence. I narrow to keep only the last time step, and I send this through my readout linear model. So this, bottom line, this is a simple model that will take a single sequence and produce a single vector as output, and we can use it exactly with as the two other models I showed in the previous slides. We can use it with the training procedure we had. And now, if I plot the performance, it's very close to the or little or simple model with gating. This does not reflect at all the capabilities of LSTM because my toy example is very simple. The sequence classification one is very simple. So it's more to show that it behaves as well. And similarly, the error as a function of the sequence length is very close to our gating model. So the LSTM were simplified in 2014 into the gated recurrent unit, GRU. So roughly the main point was to have a single gate instead of two to modulate the update of the recurrent state. So again, we have a reset gate that states if we should completely discard the recurrent state or not. We have a forget gate that modulates how much we should remember from the previous hidden state. And we have the full update, which has this particular that we can completely discard the previous hidden state before. So basically, should we take into account only the current element from the sequence or also the hidden state? So this is what it modulates. But then also you can modulate how much you take into account the full update. And again, I can write exactly as I did for the LSTM model. I built my little module, and it's exactly the same. Except that instead of using the LSTM module from PyTorch, I use the GRU module. But otherwise, it's exactly the same. You have multiple layers. You can have multiple layers, etc. And then, if I apply this to my toy example, again, we get something very similar to LSTM and very similar to our simple model with gating. So all this is consistent. All this is more to show how you can use this in practice, but again, to really see some differences between LSTM and the simple model we propose, we would have to go to a real scale example. So an important technical detail if you really use this on real scale problems is that the pass-through and the gating mechanism are a very efficient tools to prevent gradient vanishing, but it may not prevent gradient explosion. So the gradient may have an explosive norms and may become very, very large. So a quite brutal way of dealing with this in practice is to use gradient norm clipping, which consists of rescaling the norm of the gradient to a fixed threshold when it is above. So basically, if your gradient is in a sphere of radius delta, you keep it unchanged, and as soon as it gets outside this sphere, you rescale it to a radius of delta. So you put it back in the sphere. So in PyTorch, we have torch.nn.utils.clip grad norm, and it applies this operation to the gradient of a model as defined by an iterator through its parameters. So you have to pass to this guy both an iterator over tensors on the maximum norm. And so in that case, what we see is that if the norm was, if I say that delta equals 5 and the norm was already below 5, it remains unchanged. If I set delta to smaller than to a value smaller than the norm, here 1.25, then it's clipped to 1.25. So now something that may be slightly unpleasant is this impression of complexity of LSTM and even complexity of GRU. So there was a paper from 2015 where the authors tried to get a quantitative and exhaustive view of the necessity for this complexity. So what they did was to explore in a systematic manner many variants around the architectures of the recurrent units, and they compared LSTM and GRU with other versions where you have different type of gating, different type of hidden recurrent state. And the conclusion was that they could not find something that was outperforming LSTM in a systematic manner. So there were architectures that outperformed the LSTM on some problems, but overall, LSTM and GRU remain quite competitive and are still highly used in practice. So bottom line, if you need to process sequences with recurrent models, GRU and LSTM remain the two choices you can use without feeling like you are doing something suboptimal. So at the moment, there is kind of a trend of moving away from recurrent models by processing sequences in a very standard convolutional manner. So there is a paper, a very recent paper from 2018, but this idea of processing sequences with the convolution, so with temporal convolution networks, dates back from 1989, so it's not a new idea. But in practice, they are super efficient, so the convolution models can be deployed so efficiently on GPUs and with all the tools and we have at our disposal that they are now highly competitive even for sequences. So in practice, it's quite simple. It's really that you have your input, and what you are going to do is to do a 1D convolution with try to, in the end, have a final decision. And thanks to using dilated convolution, so you can increase the support of the taken into account for the final decision. You can increase it exponentially. So overall, the model size will be of the big in logarithm of the temporal horizon you take into account. And the memory footprint of computation would be T log T, because you have still to look at all the sequence at least once, and then you go, the number of layers will be in the log of the number of time steps, because you have an exponential increase of the support. So this paper from 2018 shows that at least on the problems they considered, using temporal convolution network is extremely competitive. So it, not only it's simpler, but it works very, very well on those examples. As far as I know, it's really what is being deployed now for all the applications such as natural language processing, translation, speech processing, and such. Okay, so now we move to the second topic for today, which is a bit of NLP, natural language processing, and in particular, the most impressive tools in this field, which are the word embeddings. So here we are going to discuss word embeddings in general and continuous bag of word, which is one of the variants that works very well. So a quite important application for machine intelligence is natural language processing, and it appears in many applications. So speech or handwritten recognition, auto captioning, part of speech tagging, sentiment prediction, translation, question answering. You can imagine that for many business models, that's quite central. And while language modeling was historically addressed with formal methods, taking their roots in all the generative grammar and Chomsky's work and such, state-of-the-art models today and deployed methods are heavily based on statistical learning and deep learning. So a core difficulty of natural language processing is to devise a proper density model for sequences of words. At the core of any use of natural language processing, you want to be able to either predict the next word or have a statistical model at the level of the sentences that itself require a statistical model at the level of the word to spot synonyms and subtlety and redundancy on many aspects of the language. So the problem is that there are so many words in any standard application, so it's on the order of tens of thousands to millions, that you cannot brutally attack the density model by saying, okay, I'm going to enumerate all my triplets of words or quadruplets of words and just compute empirically the frequencies of each of them. So the standard strategy to mitigate this problem is to make it a geometrical problem, so to associate to any word a point in a Euclidean space, and then to take advantage of data regularity in that space in a geometrical sense for further statistical modeling. So the geometry after embedding should account for synonymy, but also for identical word classes and other relations. So you want this geometry to, of course, reflect that, I don't know, cat and kitten and tiger somehow are close, but you would like also this embedding to reflect that red and blue, even though they are quite different colors, are both colors that in many situations can be used similarly, or that it and work are two words that also can be used in many different situations in the same way. So you want to reflect those similarities that go beyond just synonymy in a geometrical manner. And the solution to this is word embedding. So this associating really a geometrical position to words. And even though those embeddings are not deep techniques per se, they are at the core of deep learning because they create the bridge between the world of words and the world of continuous signal with geometric consistency. That is the stuff deep learning can process easily. So let KT be a sequence of words that are already encoded as IDs. So W, perhaps W will be the number of words in our vocabulary. And we consider that we have a text that has been encoded as sequences of integers between one and this big vocabulary size. Given an embedding dimension D, the objective of an embedding algorithm is to associate to every word of the vocabulary a vector of dimension D such that similar words, in whatever sense it has, will be encoded with similar vectors in a geometric sense. So again, KT is going to be the training set, so it's a sequence of words, a corpus of text, let's say all the Wikipedia content, already encoded as indexes in the vocabulary, so with big W is a number of words in this vocabulary. And in what follows, EK is going to be the vector associated to word K, where K is between 1 and big W. So a very standard embedding is the continuous bag of words, proposed in 2013 by Mikolov and colleagues. And in this model, the core idea is that the embedding vectors are such that if you take a word in your sequence of words that you use to train, if you take a word, if you sum the embedding vectors of the words in its neighborhood, so let's say the 5 words before and the 5 words after, so if you sum those 10 embedding vectors, you can predict the word itself from the sum of embeddings. So we can make this a bit more formal. So C is going to be the size of this neighborhood, this context size, an integer strictly greater than zero. I'm going to use Big CT for the set of the indexes of the words in the neighborhood of T. So the C indexes of the C words before T and the C words after T. T itself is not there. And so we can see it like that. You have your sequence of words that goes from 1 to big T. And here we are at small t. And the CT is going to be all those indexes. So those guys are each of them is between 1 and W. And all those guys between 1 and W. So it's 2 C indexes. And we are going to optimize in the C-Bow model. We are going to optimize the EK into RD such that we can also train at the optimized jointly a matrix M so that when we sum in a neighborhood the embeddings of all the words around T, so this is the sum of the embeddings of the C words before word at location T and the C words in the after the location t, and we multiply this by m, this overall expression that we denote psi t is a good predictor of who is kt, what is the word at location t. So this in the sense of the cross entropy. So we want that basically the score associated to the real world, so the score corresponding to kt, will be large and the others will be small. Okay, so again, to summarize, we want to optimize the embedding vector so that if you sum all the embedding vectors of the words before a certain location and all the embedding vectors of the words after a certain location, this in a small context size, you get a vector of same dimension, so the same dimension of the embedding space, that allows you to predict with a linear model what is the word in the middle of the context. So we could optimize the cross entropy, but given the vocabulary size, because usually big W is of the order of tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, because you have a lot of words, unique words in the language, due to plurals on the verb grammatical forms and many different variations. So usually you have too many classes, so the way proposed by Mikolov and the colleagues in 2013 was to use negative sampling. So instead of re-optimizing the cross-entropy, which means to push the score of the correct word upward and the score of all the other words downward, what you do is that you sample a few words in your vocabulary, and you just say that those words should have a low score, because this vocabulary is so large that if you take a bunch at random, they are very unlikely to be close to the one you want to predict. So basically, you want to push the score of the correct word upward on the scores of a bunch of words downward. So here I pick Q of them. So in the end, this is the loss we want to optimize, which is we want this to be small, which is we want this to be large. So this is a logistic loss. And we want this to be small also, which means we want those guys to be small. So okay, if we put all this together, we have a vocabulary. We are going to optimize one vector for each word, such that if we go at any location in our training sequence of words, if you sum the embeddings of the words before a certain word and the words after a certain word, so again, let's say five before, five after, so you sum 10 embedding vectors, you get a new vector which is in the same embedding space, in the space of dimension d, and you can from this predict linearly the vector at the center of the context, which means that you are going to produce a vector which has as many scores as the number of words in your vocabulary, and you want the score of the correct word to be high, and you select at random q other words for which you want the score to be small. So in practice, the operation that maps a word index to the embedding could be implemented with a matrix product by encoding the word index as a one-hot vector, but that would be extremely suboptimal because we would end up doing a lot of products and additions that we know are useless, because this one, especially in this context with a very large vocabulary size, where there would be 10,000 zeros or 100,000 zeros and only one non-zero entry. So what we do in practice is to actually use a module which implements explicitly this as a lookup table. So in PyTorch, it's called nn.embedding, and it's defined with a vocabulary size n and an embedding dimension d. It has inside a matrix that encodes embedding vectors. And what does its forward operation? It gets a long tensor of an arbitrary dimension, so it can be here, it has u dimensions, a1 to au. This long tensor contains indexes, contains coefficients which are between 0 and n minus 1, again, this being the vocabulary size. And this forward operation will return a float tensor which has the first same dimensions and one additional one, which is the embedding space dimension. So formally, if x is a long tensor containing the word indexes, and again it has here u dimensions, what you get is a float tensor which has one more dimension, and if you look at So coefficient D for a certain, when you fix all the first indexes and you move along the last one, what you do is you actually move along the geometric dimension of the intervening space. So this is a simple example where we create an embedding for a vocabulary of size 10 on an embedding space of dimension 3. Here we build a long tensor, a variable on a long tensor of dimension 2 by 4. And if we compute the image through this module, what we get is, as expected, a tensor which first dimensions are the same, 2 by 4, and the third dimension is the embedding space dimension. So our model will have two embeddings, one which is the one we are truly interested in, which is embedding from word to the embedding space, and the other one which is the one we use to do the prediction. So remember that we are going to learn those guys such that if we sum the embedding of words in a certain context, we can predict with this guy the ID of the word in the middle of the context. So the forward operation of our model, we get two tensors, one which corresponds to the IDs of the words in the context, and the second one corresponding to the IDs of the words for which we want the score, the prediction score. On the first dimension, because we are going to watch by batch, the first dimension is the batch. So we will get the first tensor, we will have as many rows as there are batches, and two C columns corresponding to the IDs of the C words before a certain location and C words after a certain location. The second tensor will have the same number of batches and R number of IDs, which in practice will be 1 plus the number of negative words we are going to use for training. So the first will be the positive one and the others will be the Q negative ones. And this model will return a table, a tensor of score of scores. For each batch, each word, we will have a score corresponding to the product between the sum of the embeddings in the context, the sum of the embeddings of the word in the context, times the readout for the word we are interested in. So the model is very compact to write. We keep track of the embedding dimension, and then we create the embedding. This is the guy we are truly interested in, and this is the readout. And now if we get the context words and the words for which we want the prediction, we just first compute the sum of the embeddings of the context words. We have to unsqueeze and transpose to put things in order for the product that follows. And then we compute we extract the vectors for the words we want to compute the scores of. Prediction scores off, and we just do a matrix multiplication by batch to get the final scores. So regarding the loss, we can use binary cross entropy with a logist loss, which is exactly what we need. It's basically cross entropy when you have only two classes, so it computes a score like this. So we'll use it by simply stating that we give a positive label to the first word of every group of. As I said, we are going to have groups of words where we have the positive one and Q negative one. So we'll say the positive one has a label one and the negative a label zero. And it's a good idea to use this instead of rewriting it from scratch, because when you do this operation, you have to be careful with some numerical stability. You have to, in practice, compute first, subtract the maximum value before computing the exponential so that you don't have a numerical explosion. Okay, so before training the model, we have to prepare the data tensor of the word IDs from a text file. So we use the 100 megabyte text file taken from Wikipedia. This is available, there are plenty of them on the web. And then we first make it lower cap, then we remove all the non-letter characters. Then we replace all the words that appear less than 100 times with a symbol star. So this is a word that is replaces all the not frequent enough words. And then we associate a unique ID to every word. So then from this we'll get a sequence of length T that we store in a long tensor. and it will have a number of words, the W. And also this fix a context size C, from which we will generate mini batches each of two tensors. So again, for every location T, we'll produce a context tensor of dimension B times 2C, and a word long tensor, the value of dimension B. So for instance, if the corpus has a black cat placed with a black ball, we will get the following word IDs. So Z would have 0, because the first one we meet, everything is low caps. Black will have 1, cat 2, etc. And then we'll encode the sequence, the corpus, as this following sequence of indexes. So Z would be 0 twice, and black would be 1, and would appear twice. And the label, the tensors, the data on label tensors we will get would be, for the data, it would be 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, because this is so the context would be 0, 1, 3, 4, because this is 0, 1, 3, and 4. And the word in the center would be this guy, so it's 2. So again, these five words would be encoded as those indexes. And for these indexes would give this context on this target word. Same, this context on this context on this target. So this 4 is the 4 in the middle, and the 2, 3, 0, 1 is the context. Okay, so I don't know how clear this is, but we first build a unique vocabulary, and we index the words with their position in the vocabulary. Then we recode the corpus into IDs, and from at every location, at every single location in the corpus, we can extract a context on the target word. The context being the words before and after, and the target being the word in the center. And here, this is with C equal to, we take two words before, two words after. And so now we can train the model as follows for one epoch. We go from the beginning of the sequence to the end of the sequence, but we have to remove the batch size and the context size, because otherwise it's too large. Then we extract the batch with an ad hoc function that we wrote that give us now a long tensor containing the context index. So for every of the B samples, we will get two times the context size, so the context before, context after indexes. And we also have the target, which contain the indexes of the word to predict, from which we build a tensor of words for which we will want the score. So we take them completely at random, but then we replace the first column by the actual ones we want. So from this, we will get a tensor of dimension 2, which has batch size rows and 1 plus number of negative sample columns. And then we fill it with random values from the vocabulary size. But then we replace the first column with the target words. So now this tensor contains in the first column the words we want actually to predict, the ones for which the score should be high. And all the other columns, and there are NBNX samples of them, will contain completely random things. Now for this, we build a label tensor of same size. The first column is filled with 1, because this is a positive class, and all the others are filled with 0. So when we arrive here, in C, we have the indexes of the context words. In D, we have the indexes of the target words. And in target, we have the actual label of the target words, so 1 for the correct ones, the one in the center of each context, and zeros for a bunch taken at random. And then we just compute the BC loss that we explained before, and this is a backward pass. So now what we can do, and this is where the magic happens, what we can do now is to extract, when the training is done, we can extract the embeddings we learned. And we can compute between two words a similarity measure by just looking at the cosine distance between those two words. So if I take, for instance, Paris and Parisian, I can go to my embedding. I should first look at their ID. From this, I can retrieve their embedding vector in the embedding of the model. And what we can do is simply to compute the dot product between those two vectors and divide by the norm. So this similarity measure, the cosine distance, will account for the two vectors pointing in the same direction. And what this table shows, those are actual results I got with my with the code I showed before. Those scores are, for each word, I show the 10 closest ones in terms of the cosine distance, so the one with the highest cosine similarity. And what we see is extremely satisfying, because What is close to Paris is Parisian and French, but also Brussels, Bordeaux, Toulouse, Vienna, Strasbourg, Munich, Marseille, and Rouen. So this is where the magic happens. Doing this very, very brutal and abstract thing, just optimizing the embedding such that you can predict the word at the location by summing the embeddings of the word in the location around, you get embeddings that group together stuff. In that case, Paris is near other European big European cities. Bike is around bicycles, bikes, biking, motorcycles, cyclists. Cat is around dog, kitten, feline, pet, dogs, kittens, etc. So this simple result with this simple piece of code can make you understand why people are so happy with word embeddings and why it works so well. Because, again, simply from a corpus and not a very big one, 100 megabytes is not so huge. We already have, so fortress is close to fortresses, citadel, castle, fortifications, fort, siege, stronghold, castles, monastery. Powerful is close to formidable, power, potent, fearsome. So it really captured not only synonymy, but also similarity in semantic sense. Paris is... And again, those results are not the best. So if you train for a very long time with very large corpora, and with a similar algorithm, you can get even more spectacular results. So an alternative algorithm is a skip-gram model, which optimizes the embedding so that a word can be predicted by any individual word in its context. So what we saw was the continuous bag of word, where you sum the embeddings in the neighborhood, and from the sum, you're able to predict the word at the center of the context. But another one, the skip-gram word, allows you to predict any one of the words in the context. In some way here, you move, you outsource the averaging through completely the SGD, the optimization process. So instead of doing the summing explicitly, here you do it through the optimization, and it gives even more spectacular results if you have a bigger training set. So the relation between the semantic content and the geometry of the embedding space goes beyond simple neighborhood relations. And actually, what you can do is to do some algebraic operations in the embedding space, and it will be reflected in the semantics. So the canonical example would be that with a properly trained embedding, if you take the embedding of the word Paris and subtract the embedding of the word France and add the embedding of the word Italy, you would get close to the embedding of the word Rome. And more precisely, these are results from Mikolov et al. Paper from 2013. This is a skip-gram model I very quickly described in the previous slide. Trained on 800 million words, and the embedding space is 300. And what they show is, if you compute the embedding of France, for instance, and subtract the embedding of Paris, and then you subtract this quantity from the embedding of Italy, and then you look at what is the word whose embedding is the closest to the result, you would get the word Rome. Same if you go from Japan, you get Tokyo, from Florida, you get Tallahassee. And you can look at those results in detail, and they are very, very impressive because it reflects both who is the president of a country, what was the job of a famous character, what is the first name of some famous person, even here, what is the operating system manufactured by a company, etc., etc. Now, if you think about it, it's not completely crazy because it makes sense that the sentences where Microsoft and Windows appear will have very similar structures to sentences where Google and Android appear. So it makes sense that you will have this kind of algebraic operation working. But still, the take-home message is that a completely unsupervised training done from a very large corpus allows to basically build guess semantic content at a very at a higher level than what you would expect at first. So this is the benefit of those word embeddings, is that you can train them in an unsupervised manner on very large corpora, typically the full Wikipedia or the full archive of a newspaper. And then given those embeddings, you can now use them and use the regularities, the regularizations they provide to train a model for a task for which supervision is required, or typically sentiment analysis, where you are given a comment, and you have to predict if it's positive or negative, for instance, or question answering, where you are given a text on the question and you have to provide the answer. So this is the overall the strategy which is massively used. You train embeddings on very large corpora because they can be trained in an unsupervised manner. And then you use the regularities I provide to train a predictive model on a task for which you need supervision and labeling. So just to finish this lecture, we can see an example of NLP application, which is sequence-to-sequence translation. So in that case, it's the translation from one language to another, and the model proposed in this paper from 2014 is simply a LSTM, which is fed first with the original sequence, at some point gets a token stating that the sentence is over, and then we use the prediction of the LSTM and input it to the next for the next token. So the LSTM will get first the original sentence in the original language, then a marker that states the sentence is over, and then it will get what it has predicted so far, and from this we get a new prediction. And in this paper, they use, so it's this English to French translation. The corpus is 12 million sentences, so it's not as large as full Wikipedia or stuff like that. So here we see that because finding a training set where you have the original French, the original English sentences and the corresponding French sentences is far more difficult than just finding a big chunk of text in one language or the other. This training set contains 350 million words and 30 million English words. The model is a LSTM with four layers, and there is one for the encoding and one for the decoding. They are not the same. There is a total vocabulary for the English words of 160,000 words and 80,000 for the output vocabulary. The word embedding is 1,000 dimensions, and there is a total of 400 million parameters. Interesting technical point, the input sentence is reversed, so which makes sense somehow. You need to know the beginning of the sentence to predict the beginning of the sentence, so it's better to have the to have the information fresh in your recurrent state to make the prediction. And they use gradient clipping. An important point is that the hidden state that contains completely the information to generate the translation, because you first see the original sentence and then you rely fully on what is in the recurrent state of your LSTM and what you have predicted so far in the translation, but you do not have access anymore. You cannot look back to the original sentence if needed. All the information you need has to be in the recurrent state, and this state is only of dimension 8,000. Now, is it big or not? I find it surprising. Maybe I have a poor intuition of NLP tasks, but I find it surprising that only 8,000 dimensions can capture all the information necessary to produce a sentence in a certain language. Another technical point is that the inference is done with a beam search, which means that the LSTM will produce posterior probabilities over words. And what you do is that while you produce the probability of a word one after another, recursively, you will keep a bunch of good sentences so far, and then you extend each of them with one more word, and you only keep the k-best. So in some way, a beam search is when you have this kind of tree structure where at every point you can produce probabilities over new words given what you have predicted so far. You only keep the k best, and you update it by looking forward one word, and again keeping discarding everybody but the k best. Now we reach the point where we need to have a benchmark on the performance measure, and this is quite difficult because you can imagine that deciding if one translation of a sentence is better than another translation of a sentence is quite difficult. So the standard measure, which is unsatisfactory on many ground, but still is so far the most widely used because it's the best we have, is the Bloom score. And basically, it counts the fraction of groups of 1, 2, 3, and 4 words and grams from the generated sentence that appear in the reference translation. So, in practice, when you want to evaluate such a system, you have a bunch of reference translations for each original sentence. So, you will ask a bunch of translators to translate them. So, for each, for instance, you will have three possible translations, and then your score will just reflect if the sentence you actually produce as a translation how much it matches in terms of individual words, the pairs of words, triplets of words, and quadruplets of words. The exact definition of the blue score is quite complicated, and it goes beyond the scope of this short lecture. And also, the validity of this score is disputable since it poorly accounts for semantic. So, of course, we are just looking at presence of words. Still, it's still a reasonable measure, and what is interesting is that this model with reversed LSTM and fully trained reached very very good performance compared to other existing systems. This is the kind of result. You have to speak French, but okay, it is very, very convincing. And what is very impressive is the length of the sentences. Again, those sentences are produced from a recurrent state of 8,000 dimensions. Another result is the performance as a function of the length of the sentences. And what's interesting that if you sort sentences according to their length, the blue score does not decrease. But if you sort sentences according to their word frequency, then blue score decreases. So which makes sense. If you start to use sentences with very rare words, the system behaves poorly. And finally, one last figure is a plotting of a 2D PCA over the recurrent state. So here what they did was to input a sentence in the model, then you get your 8,000 dimension recurrent state. For each sentence you have one, what you can do is a PCA of this, so you take all your training sentence and do a PCA, and then you can look at the proximity. And it's very, again, it's quite impressive because it reflects semantics, so those sentences get close to each other. So John admires Mary, John is in love with Mary, John respects Mary, and the inverse, which of course for us it looks obvious, but all the words are the same basically, so you have to capture that the order matters, and then it's another cluster. Similarly, this cluster those sentences are clustered in one close to each other, and those sentences are clustered close to each other. Okay, so this was the last lecture I will give in this course. The three last lectures of the course will be given by speakers from Facebook and Google. That was a pleasure. I'm interested in any comments, again, by mail or whatever media you choose. I will try to update this course with a PyTorch new version, so hopefully 1.0 soon. And hopefully we will continue this course next year. Bye-bye.